commute, and therefore we have quantum fluctuations, and therefore we will get a quantum phase transition of the type that Dietrich talked about at the beginning of his today's lecture. Okay, so this is a model I'm going to look at, and I want to understand what this model is doing at zero temperature. Remember, we are doing a quantum phase transition now. So that's the transverse field Ising model. Okay, and to orient ourselves, let's first discuss qualitatively what kind of phases we can expect. Okay? So there's two competing terms, so it's useful to look at the limits. So there's two limits. If the fields are much larger than the interactions, okay? And what do you expect will happen? Right, the spins will all point in the x direction, so this is simply a paramagnet. It's a polarized paramagnet that the spins point in the x direction. And in the opposite limit, well, in the opposite limit, the other term wins, right? And since we are at zero temperature, that means we will get ferromagnetism, right? So the ferromagnetism is in z direction, whereas the polarized paramagnetism would be in x direction, right? So these are really different directions. Okay. And so this suggests that there should be a phase transition between the two. And this is indeed the case, and this is the phase transition we are going to look at, right? This model has a number of useful properties that simplify our life. This model has what's called a self-duality, because you can make a variable transformation that transforms this term into this one and this term into this one, right? Why is this useful? Well, this allows us to pinpoint the critical point, right? If I can, by a simple variable transformation, exchange these two, that means the phase transition, if any, if there is a unique phase transition, has to be when the two are equal, right? And this is certainly true for in the clean case. So in the clean case, if all j's and h's are the same, then the phase transition is at h equal j, based on this argument. But it turns out that this can be generalized. It turns out that the position of the critical point can be found exactly based on duality, and it's given by this condition, the product of all j has to be equal to the product of all h. That's the condition for the critical point. And this is nice because it's always good to know the position of the critical point from the outset. Also, this is not specific. I mean, the method does not depend on this. The method is more general, but I'm going to use this to take some shortcuts in my derivations, okay? Or in other words, if I take the log, then you can say that the average of the log j has to be the average of the log h, right? It's the same condition. Okay. Now, we are interested in the disordered case. And so what that means is, these two coefficients here, these two energies, will be random.
So, sorry, what do you mean that this self-duality can be generalized to this form and be varied?
The self-duality is still true in the statistical sense for the disordered model, right? So, because if you exchange these terms, then of course in the random case, you don't get the one-to-one mapping of the values, but you get the one-to-one mapping of the distributions. Right, and there's an exact theorem that holds for the disordered case that gives you this as a position as a critical point. Okay, so disorder, and so let's. I think it's Fudi, right? 79. Not 100% sure, but I think. And so to make our life simple, let's assume these are independent random variables. And then we can characterize them by individual distributions. Right, so there will be some distribution for the j's and some distribution for the edges. They're both random. And let me call the distribution for the j's, let me call it p. So that's p of j. And I give it an index I for initial, because this will flow later on. And there will be another distribution, R initial of edge. OK?
Going from the exact result to the result about the averages of the quantities, that's not a trivial step, right?
You mean?
Going from there to the line below?
From here?
Yeah.
You just take the log.
But one is an average over a distribution of j's and h's. The other is an exact result for a product of j's and h's. Is it obvious that these are exactly the same?
Well, for an infinite chain, right? Because the variables are independent, right? Averaging over the distribution of j's is simply the same as adding up all along a long chain.
Okay.
So this simply means average over the distribution here, right?
Okay.
It's not a quantum average or something like this. Right. Yeah? Very good. Yeah. So I want, following our philosophy yesterday, I want to look at random mass disorder, right? Which means I want to make sure that the phases themselves are not influenced. So therefore, I take all the j's to still be ferromagnetic, right? So the distribution is such that the ji's are all positive, right? And I also let's require the same for the edges, right? So if I do this, and it's a little stronger than I need, but if I do this, I'm certain that my two bulk phases, ferromagnet, paramagnet, are the same as in the clean case. Okay. Well, it sure does, right? Because you see, if you make one zero, then you cannot get a phase transition. But this is good enough to ensure that there is no other phase interfering, right? Okay, so how do we solve this, right? So now we have a problem. What we want to do is we want to do the statistical mechanics of this at zero temperature. And we want to see whether we can understand the phase transition. So how could we do this? Well, the traditional approach, based on how people approached disorder problems in the early days of the renormalization group, would be to first solve the clean problem, right? And then to set up some type of perturbation expansion in terms of the disorder. And very often this has been done using the replica trick to first average out the disorder to get some effective clean system. And then apply our G techniques to this effective clean system in replica language. And while this works for some classical systems, as I briefly pointed out yesterday, this completely fails for this problem. As I will show you, the results that we are getting are so unusual that they cannot be captured, at least have not been captured. I should be careful. They have not been captured, and it's hard to see how it would be ever possible by such an approach. So therefore, we have to do something else, right? So we are not going to try a weak disorder approach. We are not going to try to do a perturbation expansion in disorder. Instead, we are going to do the opposite, right? Let's assume for the moment disorder is strong, and let's see whether we can work with this in some way. Okay. Let's write that down. The traditional approach would be to solve the clean problem first, and then try some type of perturbation expansion. in the, this order strings. And this does not work here. And for now, you have to take my word for this. But as we go along, we'll understand why it's very unlikely that this can ever work. And so instead, let's keep the Hamiltonian. So instead, you want to develop a method that actually makes use of the disorder. And the basic idea of this method goes back quite a long time. It goes back to Madhash, Gupta, and Hu. And that's 79. And these guys were interested in the behavior of magnetic impurities in semiconductors. And so the idea that they had was to say, well, if you have a random distribution of magnetic impurities in a semiconductor, then maybe some are close together by chance, then these two spins will form a singlet. And then the singlet is magnetically inert, so let's throw it out. And then let's pick the next pair of close ones together, form a singlet, throw it out, and so on. And let's see what happens if you repeat this process. And they implemented this numerically and learned something about spins in semiconductors. The real breakthrough to make this into a full-fledged tool came when Daniel Fisher actually applied this method to this problem and found that one can solve the resulting equations exactly. Okay. So what's the basic idea here? The basic idea is, let's assume for the moment that this order is strong. And of course, what that means in our language is, let's assume that these distributions are very broad. Okay. So let's assume strong disorder. And that means broad distributions, P and R. OK, so if you are in this regime where we have strong disorder, then if you look at this chain here, and if you simply go from side to side through the chain, then we will have very strong fluctuations between the energies. And if we pick a large one, right, we go to the chain, we find a very large one, it's very unlikely that its neighbors are also large. Right? The neighbors are very likely much, much, much smaller. And what that means is that we can now use perturbation theory locally, right? Because locally, this one large energy scale will completely dominate. And there will be a local degree of freedom that we can, with a high energy degree of freedom, a local high energy excitation associated with this energy scale, which we can integrate out and renormalize the remaining chain. And then we can repeat this. And so in doing so, we can slowly reduce the energy scale and see what happens. So that's the basic idea. Right.
Does it depend on what
KTM for the next? No, let's assume that they are completely independent.
So if they are independent, then if I get a large value here, why do I expect to get a smaller value here?
The probability that you find another large one is very, very, very small. Right?
Yeah, but it's still the same as getting a large value for the first time, right? What I'm saying is if I get a small value here, does it decrease my probability to get a large value there? It's just
no, of course not. But if the probability of finding a large value itself is only 10 to the minus 5, right?
Yeah.
Then the probability that you have a second large one next to the first one is only 10 to the minus 5, which means in all other cases, you are in the regime that you want, right?
OK, I see.
OK, so we assume this. Then that means locally, a single ji or a single edge i dominates And then what we are going to do is we're integrating out the corresponding high energy excitation. Okay, that means we do this. This renormalizes the couplings in the neighborhood of this strong site. And we get a new chain, and then we can iterate this and watch the energy flow down, the maximum energy, and see what the chain does under this RG procedure. So that's the basic idea. So now let's actually do it, okay? So I think you all recognize the Hamiltonian now. Let's erase this. So that would be, right? Because I want to apply, as you will see in a second, in detail, I want to apply perturbation theory locally, right? Mm-hmm. So what that means is my method will be good if there is a large difference between the strongest coupling in a certain region of your chain and all the others. If the disorder is weak, then there may be some little difference between neighboring couplings, but they will not be very large, and perturbation theory is not good.
But that's a statement of uncorrelated disorder, right? Not strong or weak, but not a less correlated disorder, right?
Well, let's forget about correlations at all for the moment. That's a separate discussion. Let's make it uncorrelated for now, right?
Okay.
And if it's uncorrelated, then it becomes a question of the strengths. If the disorder is weak, that means I have maybe a 10% variation between the J's, right? Then I cannot really justify perturbation theory, right? But if the disorder is very strong, so that my J's vary over a factor of 100, right? Mm-hmm. Then in almost all cases, I will be allowed to do perturbation theory.
Okay.
So that's the point.
Thank you.
Okay, so that's now 2B. Let's actually do it. So let's do the RG transformation. And so now what we do is we go through our chain, right? And we find the largest FT2 energies. And there's two cases. The largest one could either be a J or it could be an H, right? So let's look at these two cases separately. And I want to start with the case, so let me first write it down. So we identify the maximum of all the Ji and Hi. And I want to call this omega, because later on this will be our RG energy scale if we iterate this, right? And so there's now, as I said, there's two cases. So let's start with the case where it's the field. Okay. So if largest energy is a field, let's say it's a field number 3. I think that's what I'm going to use in. Right. So let's say it's a field on site 3, which is the largest one in the chain. Then by this argument about strong disorder, that means that the two bonds next to it, which are J2 and J3, the bonds left and right, they are much smaller with very high probability. Okay. Okay. So now what can we do? Well. What's the physics of this particular site? What's the physics of site 3 if it has a very strong field? It will point in the x direction. There was a question up there.
So these two distributions are different distributions.
Possibly they are different.
So in general, you take two different distributions. But when you are saying that H3 is large, you are not saying anything about J1, J2, and J3. It's large, fine, but it does not make sure that J2 is small.
The distributions are broad, right? This is the underlying assumption. And I'm going I'm going through my chain, and I'm looking for the largest of all energies, the maximum of all J's and H's, right? And that's H3 in this case. Then with probability 1, or if they are infinitely broad, or with a very high probability if they are broad, right, all the others are small. Again, there's no guarantee. There's a small chance that this is not fulfilled, and we have to worry about this at some point. But let's for now assume that we are, have a typical case that if we have the largest energy here, the other ones are smaller. That's certainly what will happen with high probability. And as you correctly said, that means that sigma 3 will be pinned in x direction. And that means it will not contribute to the ferromagnetism, right? Question? I want to assume that the distribution is broad even on a logarithmic scale. That's a precise statement. Yes.
So that means it must be very
It has tails. That means it has tails, yeah.
I mean, there's a question. I mean, either we do the usual arching cheating, we conceptually we assume it's large, but in fact it's not large and not very broad. And we trust,
Don't think in terms of Gaussians, right? We are trained, to, as theorists, we are trained to think in Gaussian distributions. Right.
But your positive age, you mentioned, tends to be, so you have a very skewed distribution that.
Exactly.
Large positive age,
right. It will be very asymmetric distribution, yes.
Asymmetric.
Yes, absolutely. And as we will. We will come back to this. This is, of course, a very, very important question. For now, I assume that this is okay, the case. I assume that I have a distribution that's broad enough that these arguments make sense, right? What happens if we have a realistic distribution is a question we will address, but not now, okay? So sigma 3 does not contribute to the ferromagnetism. So that means we can throw it out if you are interested in the magnetization, right? So. You can decimate, throw out sigma 3. But we need to be a little careful. If we simply throw it out of the chain, right, then the chain falls apart into two halves, and then we can never get ferromagnetism. So that's clearly a bit too much, right? We cannot throw it out. So we need to keep the virtual excitations of that site, because they will create an effective coupling between the neighbors, right? And this can be worked out in perturbation theory. That's where I need the perturbation theory I was talking about. So the virtual excitations of sigma 3, they create a coupling between sites 2 and 4. Right, and now you just do what you learn in your quantum mechanics class. You do perturbation theory, right? It's a very simple system. You just have three sites. You have sites 2, 3, 4. You do your perturbation theory. And of course, you can already guess what will happen, right? The second order perturbation theory. So we can already guess what the result must be. So we will get an effective coupling, which I'm going to call J tilde for now, between sites 2 and 4. The large energy scale has to go in the denominator, right? So it would be H3. And then the two small ones have to go upstairs. So it will be J2, J3. Right? These are the two points that are neighboring to the site. Or in pictures, what we have done is, we have sites 3 And now, so that's sites 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And now we have this new bond, J tilde 2, 4. Right, so this was J1, J2, J3, J4. So we have gotten rid of one site, and we have generated one new bond. OK, so that's the RG step in that case where the largest one is a field, J2, J3 over omega. And now let's look at the other case. The other case looks similar. So if the largest is now an interaction, right? Largest energy is an interaction, say, J2. Let me just stay consistent with my notes. Don't write wrong indices later on. Yeah, I want to use J2. And then again, in almost all cases, it means the neighboring fields will be weak. So J2, probably cannot see it over here, right? J2 is then supposed to be much larger than the fields at the two sites. So the fields on sites 2 and 3, H2 and H3. OK, so now we have to, again, ask ourselves, what's the physics in this case? What's the high energy excitation that we want to throw out? So if we have two sites that are strongly coupled by a bond, right, these two here, that's a strong bond. So what's the physics of that case? They will be parallel, right? So it's favorable for them to be parallel. This or this, that doesn't matter. But these states, they are bad, right? So these we want to integrate out. So what it means is, effectively, we can replace the pair of sides by one, right? Because there's only two states left. So you can form a cluster. One, four, five. And this will be a new site here. There's two things to say about this new site. First of all, this will have a larger magnetic moment, because it now represents two spins, right? So therefore, the magnetic moment of the new site, mu tilde, will be the sum of the two moments that were before. Initially, it's 1 plus 1. But as we go along, and each of those could already be a cluster. It could be something else, but it's always a sum. So that would be mu 2 plus mu 3. And the other thing we need to know is, what's the effective transverse field acting on that cluster, right? And for this, you again use perturbation theory. So we get an effective transverse field acting on that side here, an edge tilde. And again, you can probably guess how the structure is. The large energy scale has to go down, right? So that would be J2. And then the two small ones have to go up. So it's H2 times H3. So these are the two possible decimations. And if you look at it, they have both have the same net result, right? In both cases, we get rid of 1 degree of freedom. Our chain has now one side less. And the overall energy scale has reduced, because each of the new couplings is much smaller than the old ones, right? Small, small over large. So therefore, the energy scale overall gets reduced. We remove the largest one, and put some much smaller back. Okay, so that's the basic idea. And question is, what do we do with this now? Oh, maybe before we go on, let me make one remark that will become important later on. There's something interesting going on here, because you see the magnetic moments renormalize additively. The energies renormalize multiplicatively. You may want to think about what that means, right? Maybe about the relation between energies and cluster size. I'll come back to that question. But this shows up already here. OK, so back to the main question. What do we do with this? Well, one thing we could do is we could actually now put this on a computer, right? So let's generate a chain in the computer with random values for these, and then simply do these steps iteratively, right? You go through the chain, you iterate this, and you go through the chain again, find the biggest one, do it again, and so on. And you could watch what happens to these interactions. And people do this, right? And it's particularly useful for systems where things are more complicated than this model, so that the exact solution I'm going to show you is not possible. However, maybe somewhat surprisingly, it turns out you can do more than that. You can actually continue analytically, and that's what I'm going to show you now. So the basic idea is that we now iterate this, OK? And so that's now the next section, that's 2C, about the flow equations. So now we iterate. These are G steps. And what question?
How is it possible to do the right way? Why just like H square and H square drop out of the equation?
So you're worried about terms acting on a single side, or over here, terms like J2 over H, over omega. Right. Yeah. Let me quickly think. You don't need them, but let me see if I can right away see the argument. Well, you actually need to flip both spins, right? In order to flip the cluster, you need to flip both spins. So you need there will be no term of that kind. But yeah, but it will take you back to the same state. It does not contribute to the right. What you need is a term that takes you from up to down. Yeah. These two here? These two, okay. Very good question, right? So I swept this under the rug, but it's of course a very important question. In the same way, of course, you could ask why I'm allowed to restrict myself to just three sites here. Shouldn't I also worry about these, right? And this is true in principle. Of course, see, there are small corrections to the bonds here or here. But it turns out that in the limit of broad distributions, these are subleading. And let me not go there for the moment, because it will be a longer discussion, and which keeps me from discussing the main points. It's a very good question, and this needs to be shown, of course. And Daniel Fisher has done this. There's a famous or notorious 50-page paper in PRB where he works out all these nitty-gritty details, okay, which I'm not going to talk about, because I want to show you the basic flow of the method. It's a very good question, and one needs to think about this, right? Another question along the same lines, and we are at it. I've kind of implied that if I do this, that the spins on these sides here are the same as they were before. Right? That's, of course, strictly not true. Right? The eigenstates are not exactly the spin states. But they have a very large overlap. And in the limit of this order infinitely broad, the overlap becomes 1. And so there's all these types of questions that we need to answer in order to make sure this really becomes exact, which I'm going to sweep under the rug for the moment. Okay. So we want to iterate this. And what happens is that we decrease omega. And now we follow the flow of the distributions P and R as a function of omega. So we want to answer the question, how do P of R and P of J and R of H flow? OK. And so let's do this. It turns out that we can actually write this down. And it's easy enough to do it on the board. So let's assume we go through our chain and integrate out all the bonds and fields in a narrow energy range close to the cut of omega, right? So let's decimate all J and H in this interval from omega minus d omega to omega. Okay? And let's ask ourselves, how does this change the distributions? OK, so this will give us a d by d omega of, let's say, p. Let's look at p first. Okay. So p is a distribution of bonds. And I need a minus here because of this minus. How do the bonds change? If you think about the two decimations I talked about, you see it's actually the throwing out of a site that changes the bond distribution. Because if I throw out site number 3, two things happen, right? I get rid of the two bonds next to site 3. And instead, I put in this new long bond that we calculated, right? So therefore, the bond distribution gets renormalized via site decimations, OK? And now we just have to put in the two processes I just described. In every of these, in all of these steps, we get throw out two bonds and put in the new one. Okay. So then the question is, how many of these site decimations will we have? Well, that's of course governed by the value of the distribution R, that's the field distribution, at omega. Right. The number of decimations we are doing is R of omega times d omega. So we have an R of omega here that gives us a number of decimations we are doing. And now for each decimation, we have to get rid of two bonds, the old bonds next to the site, right? And their values are whatever they are. So they are grabbed at random out of the distribution. So there's a minus 2 times p. And we have to put back one new one. That will be a plus, right? And the new one is the one that has is a long bond, right? So that means we now have to encode the value of the new bond, right? And so, well, what's a new bond? Let me write it down, and we'll see how it works. Dj1, dj2 times p of j1. P of J2 times delta of J minus J1, J2 over omega. I think that's it. Right. So right, we put back a value, a bond with value J which is our perturbation formula. And this simply averages over all possible values of the two neighboring bonds that we throw out, right? So then this, what's on the board now, encodes the two processes, throwing out two old bonds and putting in the new renormalized bond, OK? Right. The field is at omega, right?
Yeah.
And by construction, all of those are below omega, right? That's how it's reflected.
Well, that's
reflected in what these p's are, right?
Oh.
Right. These all of these p's and the r.
That's the assumption.
Right. It's probably easiest to think about having run the RG a little already, right? Then the upper bound for the support of both P and R will be omega, right?
Okay.
Because I've reduced the energies for both distributions, now I'm working I'm picking a side at the upper bound, and then by construction these two are below, right? Okay, and so we are almost finished. What we have to add is the fact that if I just do this, I screw up my normalization. Give me 1 second. Because I'm taking out two bonds and I'm putting only one back, right? So if I leave it at that, this will not be a proper probability distribution because the normalization will go down. So I have to correct for this. I simply have to count how many sides I lose in total, and then I have to multiply it back, right? So we have to. This is the actual decimation that we implemented now. And now we have to add back plus R of omega plus P of omega times P. That's the total number of decimation steps. And we add it back to make it normalized. So and the first line here is from the decimation. And this is to keep P normalized. And there was a question.
Question about rotation. P and R when both upon A and omega.
Yes. So the full thing may be something like this. Right? P is a distribution of J, and it depends on the parameter omega. Okay? It's a running distribution. If we don't add this term, right, then effectively we are keeping track of the number of bonds, but this is then not a probability distribution. And as I said, we lose 1 degree of freedom, meaning both one bond and one side in every decimation step, right? And so that means I have to count the decimation steps. So the total number of steps I'm doing is R of omega plus P of omega times the omega. That's the total number of steps, right? So that means my total normalization goes wrong by one minus this times d omega, right? And now that means I have to multiply what I get otherwise by 1 plus this. Does that answer the question? OK. I'm skipping 2 or 3 lines of algebra here, but I think the concept should be clear. OK, and now, of course, we can do the same thing for the other, right? And I'm not going through the steps again. It's clear it will look exactly the same, just exchanging R and P, right? But everything was symmetric. So the flow equation for R will look exactly the same, just replace R with P everywhere, right? So analogous for R of H. Okay, and so now we have an analytical formulation of the flow of the full distributions. And what remains to be done is we have to find fixed points of this, right? If there are any. And then these fixed points should correspond to either critical points or stable fixed points at the driving phases of the system. And that's what we have to discuss in the remaining, I think, 35 minutes or so. When did I start it? Yeah, OK. Right, we are working with the full distributions, right?
So the question is whether this pair of integral differential equations converges.
Exactly, right. Yeah, and that's where the power of the method comes from, right? That the method works with the full distributions as opposed to just averages or maybe a few moments of the disorder, what the traditional methods do, right? It keeps track of the full distributions. Right. Right. So it's clear for the system to be self-consistent, right? We need to make sure that distributions are actually broad, or remain broad, or get broad, or right. If the distributions do not get broad or remain broad, at least.
Yeah.
Right. Then this clearly breaks down, right? What we would ideally want is that they get broader, and as you will see, just to give you a spoiler, we will actually see that they do get broader, making this better and better and better, and that's why it becomes an exact solution in the end, right? But of course, at that stage, that's not obvious, right? At that stage, we still assume that we are allowed to do what we are doing because they are broad for whatever reason. Okay.
Okay.
Right. So. So how do we solve them? I cannot do it in full glory on the board, but we can at least sketch the main steps. Okay. So one thing that it's very useful to is to go from these variables h and j to logarithmic variables that effectively measure log h and log j. And you can guess why this might be a good idea, because we already have seen that we have this multiplicative structure in the recursions, which would then turn into an additive structure, which is easy to deal with. Right? So let me do this. Let me introduce logarithmic variables. Uh-huh. That's one way to look at it, right? Yeah, so in this case, I would say the duality guarantees that they have to have the same form.
So now, even the flow equations for P and R also look very similar.
Yeah, they are identical after this. Yes, yeah.
And that also is a reflection
of the duality, yes, yeah, right. Now, OK, let's leave it at that for the moment. We don't need this for the method to work, right? It's just convenient. Yeah? You want me to draw one? Well, I don't know. We could start from something. Right, so the initial bare distribution, right, could look like this. That would be fine. It would fulfill what we want, right? It has to be positive, and something like that, right? Of course, this would not fulfill the condition of being broad enough to really justify this. If you want something like this, draw something like that, right? That's much better. But in principle, all of those would be valid initial distributions. Now the question is, how do they change as we do this here? Okay, does this answer the question? Okay. Okay, logarithmic variables.
One more thing.
Okay.
With the new notation of having omega as a suffix,
yeah.
Where does those suffixes go in the guidance?
Everywhere. They are all running.
For example, in the first R omega, there is a omega in the suffix also.
Yeah.
And in the second one, there
everywhere, right? They all have. Right, so
the last P is P omega
j. P omega j, yes, like that. Right, so they have two different meanings, right? The one that I wrote as argument, that is the argument of the distribution, right? It's a probability distribution of that variable, and here it's taken at the upper bound. This here is the parameter, right? Because the distribution runs with the cutoff. Right, that's the parameter, and this is the argument of the distribution. Is the notation clear? I mean, I can write more, but then it takes longer. So if something is not clear, ask me, because I'm going to skip a few things. If you feel you need more, you need to ask me, OK? So log variables. So I want to introduce a logarithmic measure for omega. So I define gamma being the initial omega over omega and the log. Right, so that means gamma goes up starting at 0 as I run the RG. And then I need a logarithmic measure for the two variables. So I'm going to introduce, let me see which I'm going to use. I think I call them zeta and beta. Yes. So zeta is log of omega over j. And beta is log of omega over h. OK, so that's my new variables. And now you plug all of this in, right? And you transform your differential equation. After a few lines of calculations, let me write down what you get. So let me make sure I don't forget anything. So we get dp by d gamma. And this is now a p gamma of zeta, right? So the meaning of the notation is the same, right? This is now a distribution of zeta. And strictly, I should have called it p tilde or p bars. And it's a different function, of course, but I'm going to not to do this. And gamma is a running parameter, the RG scale, right? So I'm not going to write this everywhere on the right side, but that's the meaning. And this is dp by d zeta. So this first term is a new term that comes from the variable transformation. Okay. Then there is plus, let me write it down first, p naught minus r naught times p. And here, P naught is simply P at the cutoff, right? The cutoff in these variables, the cutoff is now at 0, right? If J is at omega, I get the 0. And then we have the term coming from the new bond, right? So this is the normalization, effectively. And then we have the new bond plus R naught times integral, let me write it out, d zeta 1. I need some space here. P of zeta 1, P of zeta minus zeta 1. OK, now you already see why this was a useful operation. Because in the original formulation, the term that contained the new bond had this multiplicative renormalization in there, which is very hard to deal with. But because we went to logarithmic variables, the multiplicative renormalization turned into an additive one. And then this simply became the convolution, right? Here? It's actually a minus because I combined the normalization term with the first term in the bracket that you wrote down. There was a minus 2 times p, and I combined these two, and this gives this. Okay. Right. So that's what we get. It looks already much nicer, right? Because we know how to deal with convolutions, whereas we don't really know how to deal with this multiplicative stuff in a delta function. And then, of course, we get the corresponding equation for the other one, which I'm not going to write down. There are still formidable things, right? There are still integral differential equations. And it's not trivial to solve them. And as I said, there is this notorious or famous 50-page paper where this is done in full glory. And I'm not going to follow this route. Instead, I'm going to use an ansatz here. I'm going to use an ansatz that will give us the physical solution that we want. But of course, this ansatz will not guarantee that these are the only ones, or doesn't even guarantee that these are the most important ones. You have to believe me that the ones that my ansatz will give you are the ones that are actually the real ones, OK? So let's use an ansatz. And the ansatz will be very simple. And maybe some of you who know how convolutions work can already guess what the ansatz is, because we want a fixed point, which means we need something that whose form doesn't change under the convolution, right? We're looking for a fixed point of this equation. And so what functions do this? What functions do not change under a convolution? These are exponentials, OK? So therefore, let's write p of zeta, p gamma of zeta as p naught times e to the minus p naught zeta. And so now, what I really mean here is this is a p naught that depends on gamma, of course, right? P naught gamma. I'm not going to write the gamma from now on. But this is a flow parameter now, right? There's only one parameter left, and this depends on gamma. And in the same way, we write r gamma of beta is r naught times e to the minus r naught. Beta. So simple exponential distributions whose widths we allow to depend on the RG scale. Okay. So maybe let me write this explicitly. P naught and R naught are functions of gamma. OK, and so now it's clear what we do. We plug those into the two flow equations and see what happens, right? And it again takes a few lines of algebra, which I'm not going to do. But the result is very nice, right? So if you do this, if you insert the ansatz into the flow equations, what we get is that we get dp naught by d gamma is minus r naught p naught. And the r naught by d gamma is minus r naught p naught. So we have turned the flow equations for the full distributions into flow equations for the parameters r naught and p naught that depend both on gamma. And these are, of course, now not integral differential equations. They are two simple ordinary differential equations that we can solve. OK? Questions so far? I'm not sure how much is rigorously known about equations of that kind. However, in that famous slash notorious 50-page paper, Daniel Fisher very carefully, using a different method, went over this equation and looked at possible solutions, right? And he found all of those that we are going to get from here, plus others that are unphysical for the problem at hand, right? So there are other solutions. And we can talk about, if you want, in private, how they look like. For the problem at hand, these are the ones that he found as physical solutions. Okay.
Okay.
I'm not sure how. I don't think it's fully rigorous, right? But he did a very careful job analyzing what other solutions might be possible.
Thanks.
Okay, so then let's try to discuss the solutions of this and try to get some physics out of it. Okay. So in my counting, that's now section 2C, D, right? Doesn't matter. I think it's D, 2D. And we will find something that's called an infinite randomness fixed point. And what that means will become clear as we go along. OK. So I want to start by actually putting myself at the critical point. Right? These two equations, of course, hold not just at the critical point. We have not made an assumption about being at criticality. But we know how they simplify from duality. Right? That's why this helps us now. From duality, we know how they simplify at the critical point. Because we know at the critical point, from duality, the two distributions have to be the same. Okay. And so at criticality, we know that R naught has to be equal to P naught from duality. So this is a little bit of a shortcut, so we can avoid finding where the critical point is. Here we know it already. And that means, of course, in this case, we only get one equation. So let me write it in terms of P. Right? R and P are the same, so let me write it in terms of P. So then we get dP naught by d gamma is minus p naught squared. And of course, that's easily solved, right? So that means we get p naught of gamma, or p naught gamma is 1 over gamma. Right, and in principle, there would be an integration constant, right? However, remember how we defined gamma. Gamma was defined as a log of some initial omega over omega, right? And I can always absorb the integration constant in redefining this initial omega. That's an additive constant, right? So therefore, I can drop it here. I can always redefine my omega I to make it go away. So what that means is that our P of zeta is now 1 over gamma times e to the minus 1 over gamma times zeta. OK, so let's look at this. That's very interesting. And the most important point at that stage is, as gamma gets big, this gets broader and broader and broader, right? And it gets broad on a logarithmic scale, right? So it does exactly what we need to make the method work. Because zeta is a log of j, and the distribution of the log of j gets broad, and it gets arbitrarily broad in the limit of gamma to infinity. So that means our perturbation theory gets better and better and better, and that's why the method becomes asymptotically exact. Okay. And of course, we get the same for R. I'm not going to write it down. You can also transform this back. You can transform this back. Let me get the prefactors right. You can back to J, right? And then you get P of J. And this would be 1 over J, 1 over gamma, J over omega, times 1 over gamma. So it's a power law distribution. And let's look at the structure. That's very instructive. So you see it has a 1 over j prefactor here. And then you have a j to the 1 over gamma. So that means as the RG flows, this distribution gets closer and closer to a 1 over j, which is, of course, a very singular non-normalizable distribution. So this is barely normalizable. If you want, that's the strongest possible power laws we can get. it's almost non-normalizable at the weak, at the low J end. So it's extremely broad on the log scale, and everything piles up for very, very weak bonds, right? Gamma was the logarithmic measure of the energy scale. Yeah. Okay, and so the distributions get broader and broader as we flow, right? And they become infinitely broad as we run the RG to infinite gamma, meaning to zero energy. And that's why the fixed point, or the critical point, is called an infinite randomness critical point, because the distributions of the parameters in the Hamiltonian become infinitely broad on a log scale in the low energy limit, right? So that's where the term comes from and what it means. Broadens without limit with omega to zero. Infinite randomness. Okay, so now let's see whether we can actually get some physics out of it. Right now, it's pretty cool. We know about the Hamiltonian parameters, but we have not really learned anything about measurable things, right, or exponents or something like that. So let's try to get out at least a few things in the remaining 15 minutes. Yeah. Omega to zero is a limit where I've thrown out most of the bonds and sites already, and I'm only looking at the remaining low energy degrees of freedom. Right? And as we see here, what happens is that the distributions actually become broader as you do this, right? And then don't become flatter, they become broader. Right.
And then you show that there is an asymptotic solution that looks like this.
Uh-huh.
But there is no guarantee that if you start with whatever you start with, that you actually wind up there. Is
that no, there isn't. There is not. So in general, what you say, of course, is absolutely correct, right? There is no guarantee that if you start from some moderately broad distribution initially, the flow is actually to this, right? What we can see from here is that if you start with something that's already broad, right, then we flow to this, right? If our initial assumptions are okay, then we end up here.
And
well, you certainly don't see it from what I did on the board, right? Because I've been using this ansatz, which, as I said, Fischer did a much more detailed job, right? He actually classified possible solutions, and he showed that there is a finite set of possible solutions. And provided the method works at all, right, so that then you can look at the... So, I see there's two separate questions here, right? One first question is, what is the set of possible solutions to the equations I wrote down, right? This was analyzed in some great detail by Daniel Fischer. And it turns out there are those, and then there are some others, but there is a rather good understanding about under what conditions you flow to either, right? Can talk about this separately. Let me finish. The other question is, what happens if you start out with something that's not broad, right? Because then the question you should ask is, do I ever flow to the regime where I can apply this theory at all, right? And that requires separate methods. So you cannot answer this within this method, of course. You need to add other methods in order to convince yourself that that's what's going to happen. And there's two things. First thing is, you can do numerics, right? You can start from a moderately broad distribution and play with the distribution and then see numerically, do you flow there? Second, you can invoke the Harris criterion. Because the Harris criterion tells you what happens if you start with weak disorder. Right? For weak disorder, Harris criterion tells you, in this case, I didn't talk about this, but if you do it, you find disorder increases. So therefore, you know that weak disorder, perturbatively weak disorder, will start to increase. Right? And while this is no guarantee that this increase will lead you to this, I think it's a very good argument that it might.
So. So naively, I would have thought that you get a Gaussian log normal distribution or something like this.
Yeah.
Because the renormalization process is a multiplicative process, which normally leads to a logarithmically broad distribution. But then you would think that maybe it's a law of large numbers that then eventually gives you also exponentials. But that's not right, right?
Yeah, you see, it's almost right, right? Because these are not so far away from log normal distributions, right? But they are not quite, right? And so technically, I think this has to do with the extra steps that you have to do when do the renormalization. You're not simply adding things up, right? I think that's a technical reason why. So these log j's are not simply the sum of the logs of the original ones. If this was the case, then your argument would go through, right? But there's more going on here, and I think this is what makes them somewhat different from the log normal ones. Okay, so one thing we can, for instance, ask, and this will be very useful, as you will see in a minute, we can ask how many bonds survive at a certain RG scale. Okay, let's assume we run the RG for a while, and let's ask how many do we still have at a certain scale. Okay, so let's ask this question, and we will see in a second why this is an interesting question to ask. So the number of surviving, let's say, sites, right? Like sites or bonds doesn't make a difference because we have a chain. We always have exactly the same number of sites and bonds. Oh, it can, because they become broad on a log scale. Right? The values all collapse, right? Because omega goes to zero. So we need to be careful what we mean when we say broad, right? I mean broad on a logarithmic scale, right? So that means the log of j has a broad distribution. And that's completely compatible with the values altogether collapsing, as you can see from these explicit formulas. Right? The j itself, all j's go down, right? By construction, that's what we did. But while doing so, the log of j gets broader and broader and broader, which means that the typical ratio between two j's, that gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Right? All j's go down, but typical ratios go up. Okay. So how do we find that out? Well, we know what happens in a decimation step, right? In each decimation step, we lose one. Okay, so that means we can write down how many we lose as we do our RG, right? We can write down dn. That's the number of surviving sites. That depends on gamma. Dn by d gamma. Well. How many decimations do we do, right? Well, we decimate those that aren't at the cutoff, right? So that's R naught gamma plus P naught gamma times d gamma. Right? Because as we do the RG, we decimate those in the shell at the cutoff. And since these are probabilities, so the number, let me write it like that, times n gamma d gamma, right? That's the number of decimations we do. That was the probability, and that's the number of decimations we do. Okay, and this we can solve because we know what these are asymptotically, right? We just calculated them over here. So this is 2 over gamma n gamma d gamma. And now we can integrate this differential equation. That's straightforward. And then we find that n of gamma goes like 1 over gamma squared. Or in other words, if you put in what gamma is, right? So that's log of omega I over omega to the minus 2. OK, so why is this interesting? Well, because we can turn this around and say this tells us something about the typical distance between surviving ones, right? We start out with a chain of a finite size. We reduce their number. That means the typical distance must go like the inverse of this. So the typical distance between surviving clusters so let's call it L gamma. It goes like log of omega I over omega to the 2. Sorry. Thanks. You can put it on the either side, but not on both. OK, so now if you think about this for a second, then you see this is something very unusual. Because what that does is it gives us a relation between a length scale and an energy scale at the critical point, right? And you see that in contrast to what we know about critical points, this is not a power law relation, right? The expectation would have been, perhaps, that we get that the length scale and the energy scale are related by the dynamical exponent, right, that Dietrich talked about. But you see here, instead, we get an exponential dependence. So that's the first important physical result, right? The dynamical scaling is not of the conventional power law type. There's no power law relation between length and time scales or length and energy scales, but we get the exponential. We get this exponential relation. And people call this activated scaling, or tunneling scaling, or something like this, because exponential dependence between length and time scales typically occurs in activated processes. It's just a word at that point, right? And so what we then get, if we simply translate this into a relation between correlation length and time, and that can invoke scaling for this. In this case, we would get that instead of xi t being proportional to xi to the dynamic exponent, instead of that, we now get an exponential dependence, right? We find that log of xi t goes like xi to the psi, and from here we get psi is 1/2. And that's the tunneling exponent. Or alternatively, you could say that the dynamical exponent z is infinite, right? That's the same thing. So z is formally infinite. So very, very slow dynamics that's implied by this. OK. Something else one can calculate, but not on the board, is the magnetization of a surviving cluster. Right? Right now we have a length scale. So the typical length of a surviving cluster is this, right? But it's clear the cluster has holes because we have in between thrown out sites, right? So the magnetization is probably weaker than that. And so we can calculate the magnetic moment. Magnetic moment of a surviving cluster. And this is a non-trivial calculation, but it can be done. And then we find that mu gamma and this goes like gamma to the phi. Now phi, interestingly, is a golden mean. So phi is square root 5 plus 1 over 2. And so you see this is not 2. If it was 2, that would mean that there would be no holes in our clusters, right? Because then the moment would go like the length. But you see it's weaker than the length. And so it means there is a significant fraction of holes in inside the cluster. OK. So that's the average magnetic moment of these effective sites that survive at the RG scale gamma, right? OK, and one can, of course, also do off-critical solutions, for which I have no time. Let me, in the last minus 2 minutes, just show you how to calculate one thermodynamic quantity, right? Just to see how it works, because it's very simple, actually. I only need these two results. I need the number of surviving clusters and the moment. And I'm going to calculate, maybe I calculate two things. I calculate the entropy, and I calculate the susceptibility, OK? OK, so what's the basic strategy? And here you will see the power of this method. Let's assume we want to know something like the entropy at the temperature T. So what do we do? Well, let's imagine we run the RG, starting at high energies, all the way until our RG scale hits the temperature. Okay. So then what do we have? We have thrown out a number of excitations, but all those excitations have energies higher than the temperature. So they are frozen in the ground state. We don't need them, right? All those that are below the left, right, they have energies much less than the temperature. So all the remaining j's and h's are much less than the temperature, which means all the remaining clusters are effectively free. So that means we run the RG to the scale T, and then we have a bunch of free clusters. And we simply have to add up their thermodynamics incoherently, right? They are independent clusters at that stage. So that's the strategy to find observables at temperature T. We run the RG to omega equals T. And then all decimated excitations are frozen in ground state, which means they make no contribution. All remaining clusters are free. Okay, so what does it mean? Well, let's look, for instance, at the entropy. So we want to know the entropy as of T. Okay. So we run the RG to a scale omega equal T. And then we have a bunch of clusters left, which by this argument are now free, right? And each free cluster contributes an entropy of log 2, right? It can be up or down. So all we need to do is we need to count how many clusters we have multiplied by log 2. So this would be nt times log 2. And the n I calculated a minute ago. So this would be log of omega naught, omega initial, over t to the 2 times log 2. And there's a minus here, right? So what that means is that also the specific heat has only a logarithmic temperature dependence. That's very interesting. The specific heat does go to zero as it's supposed to do, but very, very slowly, very, very slowly, only logarithmically. And again, the reason is that we pile up this enormously large a number of weak bonds, right, which survive until very low temperatures. OK, and how about susceptibility? So that's the last thing I'm going to do. So the argument is very similar. If I want to know chi of t, I run the RG to that scale. And then I have a bunch of free clusters. And so I need to know how much susceptibility each cluster contributes. But we know its moment. And since they are free, we have moment squared over temperature. And we multiply this with a number. So we have nt times mu squared t over t. Right? That's susceptibility. Right, and so from the nt, we get log of, let's pull out the 1 over t, and then we get log of omega initial over t. Now we just have to collect powers, right? So we get a minus 2 from here, and then we get 2 times the golden mean from here. OK, and in the same way, you can calculate many more things. You see, these are all explicit solutions containing critical exponents. If you believe me that one can really show that these are the physical solutions, and that a system starting out from a moderately broad distribution flows to these fixed points, and I've not shown this to you, but this has been tested in various ways, then we have an exact solution for this problem. Thanks.
So the susceptibility is stronger than purely, but just barely.
No. Correct. So two phi
this is. This is about 3.2, right?
So 2 phi, oh, it's 2 phi.
It's 2
okay.
phi. So this is a positive exponent.
This is 2 phi. So it's weaker than Curie, but just barely.
It's just barely weaker than Curie.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Can you please repeat why the remaining clusters are free?
By construction, all the remaining J's and H's are below the cutoff, right? So that means at that stage, all the remaining J's and H's are below the temperature. And since we have very broad distributions, they are much below the temperature, right? And therefore, they are free. Right. This, of course, you cannot answer based on these analytic solutions. But people have looked at this numerically. And so you can start from some distribution and watch the flow numerically. And you actually see how they distort and end up with these distributions. So this has been done. There's various numerical solutions. And you can see how it changes. Say it again.
Is there a
Of course. Actually, the phase diagram is very interesting, and I will come back to this tomorrow when we talk about Griffith phases. But since you asked, so there's actually five types of fixed points, if you want, in this, right? I've only talked about the critical ones so far. Then there's two trivial solutions. And these are the solutions that correspond to the conventional ferromagnetic phase and the conventional paramagnetic phase. And so to those you come if you start out from a distribution where all j's are larger than all edges. So if all j's are larger than all edges, you always form a cluster. You never throw out sight, right? So that will end up to be the conventional ferromagnet. In the same way, if you have a distribution where all edges are larger than all j's, you never form a cluster. You throw only out sites, right? And this will be the conventional paramagnet. So now we have three different types of solutions. And then there's two more. And these are the ones when there is some overlap between the distributions, but they are not the same, right? And in this case, you mostly throw out sites, but sometimes you form clusters, for instance. And this will be the Griffith phases, which I will be talking about tomorrow.
Yeah.